find yourself getting passed by multiple cars, as I mentioned earlier on. So Newhoff in a very precarious situation, but he often finds himself in these places. He doesn't qualify as well as he races.
Up front, they are getting with Lee Aberdeen and Luca Varani, not very far apart at all here. But I just want to see how Alistair Haig deals with Marcello Kessler coming round the old hairpin.
Best decision they've ever made, just not having done that under the safety car, really.
Yeah, they're taking their pit stop strategies from Ferrari lately or something. What's going on?
In turn one, just too much gas on them, too much feet on the round pedal, and approaches dropped him all the way down the order. But Philip Hammer is out in front by an 8.91 seconds. Michael, there's a wall there, sir. And Dunby doesn't want to be hitting that earlier on as well.
Difficult, the understeer is in the dirty air through that final corner because it's such a long corner and you get dragged off into the grass very easily. He'll have the slipstream jamming towards the chicane. Peterson was briefly alongside, but that slipstream has saved him and kept him in third.
Yeah, Varani now lost a little bit of time to Aberdeen, about half a second. Peterson is... pushed more and far and up ahead. He's got out of line. It's now Pike. Going to have a go at Werrell. Don't push him off. He's in the championship fight. Jack Werrell chasing down Carl Jacklin. Further down, Rob Williams and Chris Barnes.
Station will run outside line now, though, for the heavy braking zone. Around the outside goes the Audi R8.
Look how much Miller's caught back into play. Exactly. Miller's just such a trouble. He's left on second and change. All of a sudden, Miller's back in play.
To the back end of Phil Jocelyn. So there's been a lot of movers and shakers in this first two laps here for race.
Absolutely serious racing league. Everybody's a lot of fun. Yeah.
It's all about the entertainment, so I hope everybody is enjoying themselves out there in the chat. We know that Ron is being enjoying himself watching
the Burger King machines off into the grass a little bit there as they're really bunching up now.
Good
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to the WCP Winners' Circle Project, Round 5 from Lime Rock. I am James Parfitt. I'm going to be bringing you all the action today with a special guest of Pius. We've got Matteo Banfo in here, we've got Matteo Lugrens in here as well, but let's have a chat about what's going to happen today. Well, this will be a traditional race of 30 minutes at the Lime Rock Circuit. Each team will take to the track for 10 minutes qualifying session, followed by the race session from the starting grid. Drivers will await the countdown horn and then move off the grid at a speed of 62 miles an hour, slotting into single file for the formation lap according to the qualifying positions. The points today, well, the race is a 1.0 modifier in the series, so the championship will be awarded for each car in their finishing order, will be as follows: 50 for the win, 36 for second, 30 for third, 24th and 20. We can have a look and show you the scores on the doors at this moment in time. And as you can see on your screen there, it is Ketchum out in front on 59.75. John Jay's in second on 50.75. Then we've got Waverley in third on 47. Owego in fourth on 45. And then unfortunately FDR down at the bottom on 37.5, but there is some big points up for grabs today. They get 50 for the win, so that could completely spin on its head here this evening, and we could see FDR jump up a nice little few positions. But let's welcome in, first off, let's start as always, the man himself who's put this together, one Pius. Pius, welcome in, buddy. How are you?
Thank you very much. Great to see you again, James. How are you, my friend?
I'm very well. Thank you very much, buddy. I'm looking forward to this. This should be a good one.
We had a little early, technical difficulties happening with one of the cars, but all the mechanics have been worked out, and I'm getting ready for a great day of racing, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's one of the things that we can look forward to. Now, we've been traditionally sent the videos of course, and we've got a new one from Ketchum. So let's take a minute and look back at that.
Hi, I'm Sean, and I'm racing for Ketchum this month.
Okay, so that was the guys from Ketchum. As you can see, been putting their video together, making it as hard as ever. Pius, they're really going for this season. I think this is great, but their little videos that we're putting on, we've got another one from Roosevelt that we'll show in a little while, but they're really putting the effort in to showcase their school, aren't they?
They're really setting the standards over there. They have a great marketing team and a wonderful build team. They're really, you know, raising the bar for the whole program. We're very proud of them. It's been amazing. They came in here. It's amazing to see a rookie year, first year team, do what they've accomplished so far. It's been amazing, and it's been incredible to watch. They've definitely set a high standard.
Yeah, they definitely have.
Anybody's game still, though. I think we're definitely looking for who's vying for the next couple of wins. Is it mathematically possible for any of these teams to come back, James?
Yes, partly due to the fact that the 50 points are on the board. You've got 50 on the next one, 50 on the one after. And then they go into a 2.0 modifier for the finale endurance at the end. So there's always a chance. And I think these guys can really not look back and go, oh, well, the guys from FDR at the moment, well, we're at the bottom, we're done. Well, Vladimir might go out and win today. And that changes the whole perspective due to the fact that there's 14 points between first and second place. So, you know, if you're looking at Owego, if they grab the 36, they're going to go up to 81. If FDR grab the 50, they'll go up to 87. So they've already jumped to position, you know. So there's still time. There's a lot to play for. There's still a lot of points on the board. And I don't think anybody can really count themselves out at the moment. Don't forget, guys, in YouTube chat as well, If you are here, like, subscribe, turn on the bells and do all that other fancy jazz completely for free. We've got Giuseppe in YouTube at the moment. Let's go, Vlad. Here we go. Let's go, FDR. FDR in the chat. So FDR, big repping at the moment.
Vlad is a fierce competitor. He's actually raced in go-karts and won championships in the go-kart series. He's a fierce competitor. They definitely saved the strategy of the schools this year. It looks like saving their best for last, I believe.
Well, that's
they knew that the points were going to count, so there was a bit of strategy in this.
Well, that's always a good point, isn't it? I think that's the thing. You know, you've always put your strongest guys in at the back, and then you make them the way forward from there, you know, and I think they've done an absolutely great job. We are going into that 10-minute qualifying, so this is now where we see. Now, I will add, I like to point out, earlier on, I decided to take one of these cars around this track. Now, let's just say it didn't go very well, right? That turn one is going to be very, very tough. They've got to brake very, very early and at the top of the hill, and they've got to contend with the jump in the middle, which is what David Searles has just gone through. So it's going to be very, very interesting to see how these guys cope. Now, the thing for me is it wouldn't stop. I was going in far too quick into the corners. I had to brake about 100 meters, if not away from the corner, to try and get the thing to stop. And it was this corner that we're going down to now with David Searles. This was the one that caused me the problem. He's got to brake at the foreboard. He's got to get it stopped. Down there through the gears he goes, and down into that turn one. It is so, so tough. I completed one lap out of five where I didn't end up sticking the car into the barrier. It was very tough. So props to these young men and gentlemen and ladies here as well, who have done a fantastic job as the season's gone on there. Let's bring in Matteo Lungren. Matteo, welcome in, buddy. How are you?
Oh, what a beautiful day it is to race this Lime Rock track, and excited to see the race car drivers today. David putting on a good run here on his practice. And that's, you know, I got a feeling about Waverly. They're in third right now, and David at the helm. You know, a lot of people are, sometimes when you're in the middle, it's sort of like, yeah, where do we go from here? And I've got a feeling about David today, even though he's got the skip coming over there at Owego too, with Blythe Miller on the track. And great race car drivers overall today. Looking forward to seeing Nico and Dante race as well. It's going to be a great day of racing at Lime Rock.
It really is. Just all stars, superstars all throughout the place. All of those people that you mentioned throughout the season have just been so instrumental to their teams. It's wonderful to actually see, well, aces high for everyone. Everyone's still in the game.
Yep, there is still points on the board. Let's bring Matteo Benfo in. Matteo, how are you still, sir? Thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, it's amazing to be here. I love to witness whatever's happening on the track. I was at the schools the past week. The kids were stressed out. This is a track that, as you said, it's tough, but you know, stress is good. You know, and you know, I could see that they're practicing. They were really, really on it, and so I'm really excited for today. I want to give a shout out to Blythe, because last year he was in the marketing department with me. He was one of the key players of the marketing department from last year, so I can't wait to see him on the track today.
Yeah, I think it's going to be very interesting, especially when they change over as well. But what we can do, as times are coming in thick and fast, it's Sean Houlihan at the top from RCK at the moment, with David Searles in second place. We've got Vladimir Slater going over the board as well. He's a little bit further back in third. We've got nothing on the board from Nick Pappas, but I believe he's on his way round now through the final corner. He's going to be hurtling that car as fast as it will possibly go down over the line. Is Pappas going to get a time on the board? He isn't at the moment, so let's rely on the fact and hopefully he'll get one on the next time around. Pius, how has it been during that break period? You know, because we've had quite a bit of a break period. We obviously had the Easter holidays in there as well, so happy Easter to anybody that went out there, and hope you ate loads of chocolate like I did. How was it been at the schools in general in that way?
There's been a palpable excitement since it's coming towards championship
week soon. And May 24th, they have their championship at this exact track at Lime Rock with all of their cars that they've actually been building, displayed, and driven and tested. So it's everybody's excited. Everyone is focused, surprisingly. I thought a lot of the chocolate was going to knock them out too, you know, but kids came back hungry. Everyone seems hungry. This year, everyone has stepped up their game tremendously. And, to Mateo's point, I think the Wolverines have really been showing their fangs the last couple of weeks. As far as their marketing, has been hilarious and great. And one of their videos went viral, which was astonishing to all of us. But ever since then, they switched the flip. They flipped the switch, I have to say. And they've been on fire. Wouldn't you say, Mateo? Mateo's head of the marketing department. Bampa.
Yeah, absolutely. The past couple of months for Waverly have been a very, very dramatic, positive, dramatic change in the marketing efforts. They went viral. They've been doing everything that they're supposed to be doing. And I was there yesterday. Team's on point, the driver's on point. And so, again, really excited to see what's going to happen today.
Yeah, I think these five cars on the track are going to make it some very interesting racing as well. But what we will do is, we're coming into the last 3 minutes. Let's have a look at what Roosevelt's been up to. See the team from Roosevelt there as well. Vlad was in there. He is here today. Vladimir Slater is driving. I think overall with these guys, though, Pius, as well, what have they got to contend with today? You know, that it's a major race situation. They've got to go in and make a pit stop as well. That's going to be an interesting thing for them, because they've got to take four tires and they've got to take 20 litres or 5 gallons of fuel at the same time. So we're bringing in another dynamic where they've got to go and make a pit stop.
What's going to be amazing is to see how they prepared for this mission. They've known it's been coming. There's a possibility of weather in this, from what I'm hearing a little bit. There might be a possibility it might rain today. So we are going to see how they factored all of those pieces in. Mateo Longo, what do you think is going to be the key point for anyone else to overtake this lead or feel like they're still in the game? Do you see any sleepers?
Yeah, I just sort of, right now, I feel like, obviously RCK's got something to prove today. They can come out with Sean, who is a considerable young man and knows how to race that car. When Sean is on this racetrack, he's going to have to hold steady, because everyone is gunning for the top seed right now. And everything can shift, like James was saying, in terms of points today. That 50-point spread could put Waverly at number one by the end of the day, depending on how Sean Jay and RTK. So it's just this race in particular is going to set the bar, and RTK really pulled way ahead with the victory. So let's just see how the cards fall.
Yeah, I think going forward, there's a lot of points on the board. And I think overall, there's a lot of fight still left in these guys. Nobody can really say it's done and dusted. I think at the end of the day, they've still got a great opportunity to get as many points on the board. The next three rounds, of course, they're looking at the next two rounds, I should say, they're looking at 100 points. Just for the wins here, Pius, and that could be massive for even FDR, who's down in the last place at the moment.
Absolutely. Well, it plays a bigger picture as well, because these are 10 points that are up for the championship that will be happening live on May 24th at the same event at the top of the hill. It plays in the bigger picture that's going to be happening, because on that day, in order for you to win the championship, your car has been tested by Alfred State Motorsports to know that it's safe to drive. Trans Am champion, five-time champion in general, Chris Dyson gets to test all of these cars and just talk about the performance of these cars. And then the other part, you know, is the 10% here gets you the complete 50. So the build, the performance, and all of that is part of this event. So the kids are going to have to present on this day a 10-minute speech to talk about their projects and how they did it and what they did this year and what the winner's circle meant to them this year. And it's part of the judging criteria. It's really quite remarkable.
That's going to be very, very interesting. Putting young people up, asking them to speak and give a speech. It can be
more
daunting.
Like a presentation, James. It's a presentation that they have to prepare in front of professionals who will be judging them. And this is all part of the points. Just like the race today is part of the point structure to see who's going to win the Winner's Circle Project Championship this year. What's going on the track right now? Are they getting ready to start this race?
Yeah, we're just into the 5-minute warm-up at the moment. So we can have a look, and we will look at the starting lineup for them when they hit onto the grid. So they've just gone into that brief little moment where they do get 5 minutes just to recover, take the stretch it out, you know, sort all their breathing, make sure they're calm, and going into this race, it's going to be absolutely epic. Let's have a chat with Matteo Banfo, who's here as well. Matteo, you work with them alongside in the marketing department. Tell us what sort of things that they've got to go through to be successful with their marketing.
Oh, well, I could talk for a couple of hours for this, so I don't want to bore anyone, but basically the majority of the work has to really do with try to communicate the project and what they're doing out into the world. First and foremost, with their community. The majority of the work that they do through marketing is online and offline, whether it means outreach within the community. You know, we've seen, for example, for Roy C. Ketchum, they were able to raise significant amount of money through local businesses for the build of the car, and they were able to really communicate well the message and the program itself with the local companies and you know, local entities. So that was really great for them. And, you know, online. And then we have the example of Waverly, who went viral with a video of over 1.8 million views for one Instagram reel that they had. So that really the overall goal is to make sure that the project gets communicated out there, that really the whatever's happening within the walls of the school leaves the walls of the school. And the storytelling is extremely important itself. Telling the story of the team, telling the story of how the car gets built. There's so many layers that happens. It starts with creating the real logo, which we're seeing on the cars today, and then it goes from gear to creating social media outlets and reaching out to news outlets. We have I think Owego is reaching out to local news media, and we had some articles in the Dutchess County area that were written about the project and the schools. So overall, every school is doing their own thing. FDR is reaching out to local celebrities that live in the area, and they got an interview lined up with Chris Dyson, I think. So overall, I mean, everyone has their own strategy, everyone has their own style, but all of them are doing what needs to be done, which is communicating the project, communicating the team out there.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things that we're asking these young people to do is go out and take control of what they've got, you know, and making it as interesting as possible for them to be able to go out there and show what they've developed, what their skills are, their marketing, what they can do, how they're going to bring people in and things like that. And I think, Pius, you know, we talk about skills and we talk about life skills. You know, you go to schools over in the UK and you know, that's not there. You know, we do all these sort of things, and I think for these kids that they've got some great opportunities to take the skills that they've learned from here and take them forward into the real world.
Well, the one thing that we all know is trying to find who you're going to be and what you want to create yourself to be. it's going to take you having to learn who you are and what you're, you know. And the one thing that we've instituted in this is by one of the most wonderful professionals and human beings I've ever met, Mateo Lundgren. Pathways to Success really cuts to the point of who the person is going to become and what they want to be and what they want to radiate and how to become actually a good person and enjoy your life. And Mateo Lundgren, would you please speak a little bit about what we do with the Pathways to Success program?
Yeah, a piece of our program is about building the human character, helping these students realize not only how to get a job, you know, build skills, but how do you become a better human being? Because that's going to serve you in so many more robust ways than just having a good job. So we're trying to really go after the whole picture with student development, not just job placement or apprenticeships, but, you know, like really understanding who you are, how you become the person you want to be.
I think that's the important thing, right? We sit and we say to people, you know, you've got to, like when I was growing up, you get the whole, you know, find a career, go into college, go into university, get a career. And, you know, to be honest, I didn't actually know what I wanted to do until about 4 years ago when I started this. So I think sometimes the pressure that's there on people is always tough for them. And I think young adults nowadays, you know, and I recently gave a talk at a university where some people just didn't have a clue. You know, it's, I want to do this. Okay, but how are you going to do this? I don't know. And that's the thing. I think a lot of it is people just, unfortunately, don't know how to get to where they want to get to, Pius.
Well, we focus on why they want to do it. Why is it that you want to do what you want to do? Because I think trying to inspire the innovative spirit, entrepreneurial spirit in all of our, you know, youth should be one of the top priorities. Because I know I don't see anybody else building anything new. So we have to spark the creative and innovative mind of the next generation. And the thing about the Winner's Circle project, it's really more of a lifestyle brain that we try to give these kids. Yeah. It's more of a lifestyle than a class, to be honest with you. It's a mindset of winning. And what does it take to be amongst winners and winners all in your circle? So, you know, the circle always represents so many things, strong things in life, you know, unity and, you know, beer, like the Olympic circles that represent all of the countries, you know, the continents, and they all are together, you know, respecting and fighting in civilized combat with chariot.
Yeah. I think that's the thing, absolutely. It's a tough one, but let's have a look at the starting order we're going to have at this time. It will be Sean Houlihan will be in first with David Searles in second. Nick Pappas will be in third with Nick Rogers from Owego in fourth. And then, obviously, at the back end, we'll have Vlad Slater.
That's Blythe Miller for Owego. Just couldn't get his name on there.
So Nick Rogers is Blythe Miller.
That's right.
Correct.
Right. Okay. I'll have to write that one down.
But Nick Rogers is the captain of that ship, though. Does, you know, he's the captain
Are we about to get started here, this race?
Yeah, they're just about to go out onto the grid. They will have their pace lap to go. We're just waiting for one more, which is funny. Blythe Miller, Sean Houlihan is out in front at the moment there. If you watch the stream there, dude, it gives you all the information on that one there that I've got for you, so you'll be able to see what is going on. But Sean Houlihan will go out. Don't forget, these guys will go out onto a pace lap first, and then they will get up and running and underway. Let's see what's going on. And let's see how they get on here as well. It's very interesting.
Look at the new colors on these cars. Look at the scheme.
Yeah.
Wow.
Looking good. Looking sharp.
Looking sharp.
And Sean out in front for RCK is really making a statement there with his lap, with his practice lap. Huh?
Nah, he's not playing around today, I heard. I heard none of these guys. These guys, it's going to be wonderful to see all of the circle all together on our trip that we're going to be taking soon to Massachusetts Factory 5, all five schools. And it's going to be one circle. Even though we're competing, it's friendly competition, you know? We're all one family, so it's wonderful to see these kids thriving and competing and wanting to be the best they could be. And we're shining example of it. And are we off?
Ooh, here we go.
We're on a pace lap.
Ready to rock and roll?
Yeah, they will have to go into a pace lap first. So they will file in here.
Explain racing to some of our people that are here for the first time. So
basically what they do is their opportunity to go, oh, nope, we've got some technical issues by the looks of it, as they've all been sent back to the pits. So I'm sure our very own SGS Matthew Overton will be on that one, and we will get this up and running at the moment. So the pace lap will allow them to basically get their tyres up to temperature. Now, it's not going to be instant. Now, you see on certain series or programs that you watch, they're weaving around, they're wiggling, they're doing all that. And if you watch NASCAR, they do that for about four laps, I think it is. They've not got four laps to do that. They've only got one. So let's see how they're going to do. They're going to go driving around, make sure they know where their braking points are. And then when they come down the hill, we will be off and running. Alicia Mills, WCSD is the best. Well, there you go.
Oh, we got to love that. Is that what you said, Alicia Mills?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. We got to love the Mills family. Freddie Mills. A legend.
Alicia's always supportive. Project.
Yeah, super supportive.
Those guys are definitely legends. They won that Waverly won the championship in 2002, correct?
22
was their year. The year of the Wolverines. They also won the state championship, I believe, this year.
In football. Yeah. Yeah. In 2002, Pius, none of our students were born.
So just a quick note, guys, we had a false start from everybody, so that's why we recycled back to the race start, and we'll get it right this time.
Great.
And there you go. That was our very own Matt Overton, who's jumped in from SGS just to give us the update on what's going on. We will get this back up and running very, very shortly, I'm sure. And then we will be underway. So don't forget, guys, if you do have any questions about anything that you've seen so far, obviously we're quite far in now. We're at round five. We've only got two rounds to go. If there's any questions that you want to ask or if you want to know anything, let us know. We've got some legends up here in the booth. We've got some experts who will be able to guide you through and tell you what is happening. So don't forget to ask questions. Tell us what you want to know. Support your team and support your school. Let's keep it clean. We know competition can be fierce. You know, we've seen a few that have been a little bit border on the lines. So let's keep it clean here as well. Don't forget, we're all here for the same thing, right? For these young guys to have a great time, study hard, and enjoy what they're doing. And that is going to be the most important thing. Enjoy what you're doing. There is not many opportunities for people to basically go out and drive a car in a simulator that somebody has put in that you've built. So, you know, go out and enjoy yourselves. Think forward. Just enjoy what you're doing. That is going to be the most important thing here as well. But let's hopefully be able to get this up and running again very shortly. I'm sure they're working frantically in the background here as well to be able for them to be able to get up on track.
Hey, Pius, we got Vlad FDR in the back, and, you know, I think Vlad's gonna really show some power here, but again, it's about patience. Like James was saying, with a couple of sharp turns, Vlad's gonna have to not press the gas too hard, too fast.
Well, we're on the pace lap. Yes, Pius, we're on the pace lap, so we will be able to get this going.
I agree with you 100%, Mateo. Vlad is a formidable. It means nothing that he started from the back. He's a formidable opponent over here, and fierce competitor. So it's going to be great to see this. I think we're going to have a wonderful all-star race.
Yeah, well, let's find out as well. They've got to try, and there you go. It's a little bit of weaving from Sean there to be able to get these tyres up into the temperature and get these running so he doesn't slip and slide here. But we're going to get all the others. You see all the others are all coming in as well. We're at the base of the track at the moment before we start going up through the right-hander. We will be up over the jump. They will take off. There will be air. It's how you land it after. It's like almost being at a bit of a skate park here as well. They're still at the top part of the circuit. They'll be dropping down, going over the line. They're just grouping all back up at the moment. So here we go. They're going to start going down now. Under the bridge they will go, through the final corner, and then we will be off and running, and then we will find out who's going to take the victory there. So they're coming round the final corner now. Start finish line is just down in front of them. They are all getting onto it now, ready to go. Vladimir's at the back, and then we've got Nick Pappas in third, David Searles in fourth, and Sean Houlihan. And then don't forget, we've got Blythe in that number four spot. And once more, now they can race. Now we are off and running, and now we are underway. Sean Houlihan goes down into the first corner first.
Let's go.
David Sells in second place and Nick Pappas in first. Blythe Miller in that car there, of course, sitting in fourth at the moment with Vladimir Slater off and in the back. But we've seen it before, though, Matteo, as well, where we basically have seen people at the back and we've seen them come to the front just because the people in front make a mistake. So, Matteo Lundgren, it's not quite done yet.
Not quite done, but just lifted air there. I love that. Sean's holding strong. I think everybody getting a good first lap in is critical without focusing on how far or close behind you are. So, yeah, already Sean's impressing me, but we got David right on him. So just hold steady, David, and let's see what we can do in this race. Wow, I'm excited.
Yeah, I think they've got 30 minutes as well. It's a long old time for them to contend with. David Sells sitting not too far back at the moment. He's about a second back. There we go. Nick Pappas. Yeah, Nick Pappas has gone round, unfortunately. So let's have a look and see what he's got himself up to here.
At least he got back on track, though.
He did, but the back end's going to come round in turn
there
one.
Yep. Wow, and what a move there from, I don't know who avoided that collision, but that was a great avoiding that collision with you.
Well, I think we know that was Blythe Miller.
That was Blythe. Mm-hmm.
And then we've got Vladimir Slater sitting in fourth at the moment, up one spot from where he was, and that's all it took. One mistake. Blythe there coming down under the bridge. He is sitting 6.8 seconds back, away from the Sean Houlihan, the speed machine from Ketchum, who's out in front. He's got his braking points nailed there, Matteo Banfo, as well. He's doing a great job. 28 minutes and a pit stop to go.
Yeah, David's right behind him. I'm really liking David's pressure here.
I'm loving the pace. They're definitely breaking away. David is right there.
Yeah, and I was in RCK. I saw Sean practicing. He was totally focused. He knows the track so well, and he knows what to do and when to do it. So no surprise to me that he's, you know, holding on to this first place.
And isn't that interesting? This is what it takes, right? It's like, how many hours are you willing to put into it? And so it's just nice to see when, you know, hearing that about Sean, you know, it's no surprise to me that he would do something like that. But every time it just makes me feel like, you know, like, wow, the effort has been put in. You can see it displayed 100%. Right now.
Yeah. Absolutely.
100%. I could not say more. They're a special breed over there. At this time, I think they really went hard this year and saw a lot of creativity, a lot of dedication, always showing up to everything. Just an amazing group.
Well,
David is really, you could see that he really took the time and effort to make sure that he was going to represent his school and his name to the best. So, but I'll tell you what, anything could still happen.
Oh, yeah.
It's a long race. We've seen a lot of crazy things happen this year, this series. Right, James?
Yeah, that is completely true, to be fair, especially at Watkins Glen. It was quite an interesting one. If you haven't watched that, go back and watch it. It was very, very interesting here as well. David Searles, unfortunately, losing temps at the moment. He's just started to get it back down again. He's now down to 2.2 seconds. It looks like, unfortunately, Blythe Miller has had another little bit of a ta-ta-ta track, and I can guarantee he's come round that final corner and he has gone off.
Oh yeah. Yep.
Yep.
That was the corner you were talking about in the beginning, wasn't it, James?
Yeah, that last corner, if you get that back end wrong and you slide that back end round, you are in trouble. Now, as we spoke about FDR sitting in the final place in the championship standings at the moment, where are they sitting here currently? They are in third. They are on for a 30-point haul here, which will give them a great boost up in the championship. And that is all from keeping the car on track. It's all
there
about just keeping it on track and doing the job there, Pius.
That's absolutely exactly what we talked about. Slow and steady. The Presidents, though, are just one of the best, well-focused, disciplined teams that we've had in the Winner's Circle Project. And very proud of the Presidents over there. The Roosevelt Racing has created some wonderful students over there, and we're very proud of their team.
Yeah,
it is interesting how it's just about keeping the car on the road, isn't it, James? It's about keeping the car just steadily on the road. And I think so many people make the mistake of trying to overcorrect and go fast instead of actually really having control.
Yeah, these cars are not easy. As I said, I took it for a spin earlier on. I managed one out of five laps. I actually made it around the track. They've got to find what they're comfortable with. Sometimes you push a car and you drive beyond the ability, not only of yourself, but only of the car as well. And it can't do what you want it to do. So therefore, you get more and more frustrated and you push it harder and harder and harder and harder and harder. And then the next thing you know, there's a nice little shiny barrier waiting for you, or the outside curb, as we've seen from Nick Pappas in the light blue in front, and Blythe Miller, who we are on board with now once again. Sean Houlihan still flying out on a track here and doing an absolute stellar job. Mateo Lundgren, 24 minutes to go. They've got a pit stop to contend with yet as well, which could completely turn it on its head. There's a lot still to fight for.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward to seeing how they respond in that pit stop. But David is, you know, David's holding on 3 to 2 seconds. I've seen him close into 1.5 seconds. So Sean's got to keep his focus here. And I know he's got people in his ear trying to keep him on track. But David's going to put the pressure on him. And but I think David and Sean both are running a great race right now. Let's just see what happens as we continue forward. A lot of race left.
Oh, they've had a collision. They have had a collision by the looks of it. Nick from Blythe Miller there. We're going to have a look back and see what they've been up to. As we're coming down. He's dived up the inside. Dived the inside at the base of the hill, and unfortunately that is what has done that for them there now as well. Oh, and they've continued to have a little bit of a ding dong after. So that would be leaving you guys to sort that one out. So there we go. But it has still left Vlad doing what he's doing best. He's just driving around, taking his time, getting the car on track. He isn't the fastest, but he is now in third place.
He is definitely a disciplined driver on virtual and in real life as well. Like I told you, a little go-kart experience that he has really shown him to be quite a formidable opponent. And very bright young man. Very interesting. Wow. Very interesting when you meet him. A lot of character.
Yeah. Would you say, yeah, I'd like to. Yeah, I just want to say that David right now is really pressing on Sean. He's only a second and a half away from him. So that 1-2 spot right now is what a race we've got here. And I knew talking with David when I was at Waverly High School, I could just see it in his eyes. He spoke up in class when I was in there, and he had this courage in him that was illuminating to see. And so I, you know, this is going to be a cool way. I mean, 22 minutes left, but I mean, David and Sean are running quite a race.
Oh, it definitely is. You know, those Wolverines, as we talked about, championship pedigree, they've been there before. They are still in, they've started to really emerge as a prime contender. And it's going to be very interesting. A lot of, you know, Ketchum, Waverly are definitely amongst two of the top teams in the winner's circle so far. Wouldn't you say, Mateo Banfo?
Yep, absolutely. I mean, the Wolverines always have shown, you know, themselves and, you know, showed up when the time came. So, I mean, and again, I was there yesterday. I saw how focused they were on practicing, just like Sean at RCK was. And I mean, not that the other school weren't, but I really definitely saw some, and I saw some, like, precision and really focus on trying to make the mess out of this race today.
Listen, those Wolverines, man, they're fierce, and great people at the same time. Freddie Mills is a man. Well, you want to talk about an extraordinary character, a man of character, and his wife Alicia was the one who was in there. Lovely, great person. All of them are just we love our Wolverine family over there. In fact, Mateo. Banfo, weren't they in the movie From Zero to 100? Was you directed
the Mills?
Yes,
absolutely, absolutely. They welcomed us when we introduced Fred as a character in the movie. We showed him in his environment at home with the family. It was awesome. We were there. You and me were there. I think you were. We were. It was like the fall, and it was. With the movie, the really filming of the movie just started, and they were like so welcoming and so amazing to us.
Oh my God, remember when he built the house that he lives in.
Yeah, he's actually expanding it. That's what he told me yesterday. He's working on it and expanding. Oh, so
beautiful house that he built with his own hands.
Yeah.
And you gotta respect a man like that. Yeah, Freddie's a good one.
Yeah, you definitely have. Anybody that does anything by hand. Now, let's give you a quick update on the points. I've just been doing some maths while you've been listening to these absolutely amazing experts up here in the booth. Now, we've got Ketchum Will. If they finish where they are, right, as they are right now with 90 minutes to go, if we said that's it, this would be the situation. Ketchum would still be in first on 109. Waverly would jump up from third, they would go into second on 83. Double J would be in third, only just, mind you, on 74.75. Wego would be in fourth on 74 points, and FDR would be down on 67.5, but now would be in a lot closer to the guys in front than they currently are. So that's where they would be if right now we decided enough was enough, we're going to chop you all off, and that is the situation. So right about now, Ketchum would still come out with the victory with Waverly in second, but it just goes to show, Pius, how big a difference the points can shift when you've got Waverly would move up one as well. Double J would come right into contact with a Wego, just 0.75 behind, and then FDR still would be within cut touching distance.
It's just wonderful to know that there's so much skin left in the game, and everybody, you know, has something to fight for this late in the season, very close to championship time. It's just an exciting possibilities that could still end this. So I'm looking forward to all, you know, what's going on in the next races. This race where we are right now in the current moment is very critical to what will. Well, you know, evening the landscape is showing exactly what everybody has ahead of them. Look at this.
David's closed down from about 3 seconds at one point out to 0.9 now. I can tell you, Sean is in that car. He's starting to get a little bit nervous. His knees are weak. His palms are sweaty. He's getting it all a little bit tension there as well. And you can see with that one, Sean's got to calm down a bit here, Matteo Lungo, and he's got to make sure he can open up that gap again, because he is struggling a little bit. As the more he gets into closer with Searles, the more Searles is closing on him.
This is tail.
I don't
which
know
which one. Lundgren?
I did say Lundgren, but if he's not here, then Matteo, jump in. You'll be all right.
It's a tight one. It's a tight one. I now, correct me if I'm wrong. Like after this after Jun Jay finishes their pit stop, it'll be the remaining two, the first two will be the ones that need to do. They're the only two ones left that need to take their pit stop, right?
Yeah, they are. So
they
haven't
really
got
interesting
in.
To see. They haven't got it. So it's going to be really interesting to see, you know, what strategy sits there, because with such a short distance between the two, you know, when to do it and how to do it, it's going to be playing a crucial role. Mm. I mean, that's my two cents.
I think you're right. And I think by. Whoa!
Oh,
David
no.
Searles is off! Oh no!
Oh my god!
Oh my
god! That
yes,
happened.
Go in! Go in! No, don't go in. That would have been a good time to go in. Minimize the damage.
Yeah, that would have been, yeah.
Yeah. Go, minimize the damage, go into the pits, get it done. It looks like on average, and I'm just looking at the fact that everybody who's gone in has ended up two laps down. So I'm going to presume that it might take a little bit of a while to put four tyres on these cars, and it might take a little bit of a while to get fuel on it. But unfortunately for David Searles, that was probably your opportunity, because you were right next to the pit box. You have smoked them tyres up. They are hot, and it might have been easier just going in and getting them off at the moment, because we're going to see a lot more puffing smoke out of you. That's given Sean a break, Matteo Lundgren, and now we can hopefully go back and relax a little bit.
Yeah, I can feel Sean now, just now he's got the focus on. Just like slow and steady. Keep those turns, keep the brake on when you get to those turns, and complete this race. But again, it's the pit stop. It's the pit stop that's going to really make the mark.
He nearly got it wrong as well. He nearly got it wrong as well. David Searles just going into the pits. We'll keep an eye on this, because it does seem to take quite a while to get the tyres off these cars. As I say, a couple of people have ended up two laps down. So he must be there for quite a little bit of time beforehand. Vladimir Slate is still going round. He's still plodding along for FDR here, still doing the job, still sitting in third place. So, you know, if you're sitting at home and you're sitting there going, oh, he's only in third, I applaud you to go and jump on a simulator, load into R Factor, and see how well you do in these cars that don't want to stop. They've got more power than they care to need, and literally it is a bit of a nightmare to handle. So go out, and if you're sitting there thinking, oh, we're in last, we're this, we're that, go out and try it, because I can guarantee you, you will not. It is so hard. So hard, and these young people are doing an absolute stellar job. We've still got the likes of David Searles in the pit, so clearly it does take a very long time to change four tyres and put 20 litres of fuel in these cars, Matteo Lundgren. And now David has just started moving. Is he going to be out? Is he going to be able to get round? That's going to be the question before Sean comes out, who's also in the pits. It seems to take a little bit of a while.
Yeah, and we'll see how Sean's time compares to David's time. Again, yeah, we can always go back and be like, oh man, I wish David would have gone in the pits when he did that little spin out. But, you know, the race isn't over yet, and Sean can't take that lightly, because David's been running a great race. Mm. I mean, he truly has. So we'll just see what the pit stop is for Sean now.
Well, you see, the time on the left-hand side is coming down. It's 23, 21, 19. Davey's just got to keep it on track. Keep it on track for the outlap. And now I think Sean is out Oh, be careful, you jump the pit line there as well. Not too sure if you will end up with a penalty on that one, but he's come out 13, he's still going down. We'll give it a minute, gonna be about 10 seconds, which is roughly what it was when it went in due to David obviously making that mistake. Then we go down to Nick Pappas here as well. He's in the car for Double J. He's a junior at John Jay High School. He's into NASCAR, my man, and motorsports, and plans to become a mechanical engineer for Alpine, designing LMP1 prototype race cars for Le Mans. So there we go. And if you haven't watched the Le Mans 66 or the Ford versus Ferrari, depending on where you are in the world, go and watch it, because it is an absolute awesome film. So I do applaud you to go and watch that as well. Big ambitions here, Matteo Banfo, for Nick. He can only go and live him if he does it right, though, can't he? Matteo Banfo?
Banfo?
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, by the way, thank you for shouting out the movie. That's an amazing movie. I didn't even know it had two different titles. I always called it Ford versus Ferrari. I didn't know it had a different title. Was that in Europe that it has a different title?
If you go on Amazon, if you go on Prime, by the way, other streaming services are available. We have no affiliation with them whatsoever. You go on there, it's called Le Mans 66. If you go on Netflix, it's called Ford versus Ferrari. Same film.
Very interesting. Very interesting.
That's interesting. Oh, my God.
It is so weird. But yeah, it is a great movie, you are right. But he's got big dreams, Nick, and he can go and live them. There's no end, is there? There's no ceiling to where you can go.
Oh, absolutely not. I think that's all part of the mission, and the purpose of the Winner's Circle Project is to really help you become the person you want to be. I mean, Matteo teaches that, implements that on a daily basis. Not me, the other Matteo. I don't talk about myself in the third person. That would be so weird. But yeah, I mean, that's what we do. We really try to help the students. You know, the racing and this car, everything is a tool that we use to really help them grow. And so, the dream car, we give you some tools to. Whoa.
He pushed it. That was a change for position. That was the problem. Blythe, yeah. That was a battle for position. That was a battle for third. So Blythe had got in, he'd seen the yellow one of FDR, and he was like, oh, let's go for it. And unfortunately, he got it all wrong. So, and again. Oh Blythe. Ouch. That is going to not do that car any favors, as I found out earlier on. That steering is, you can see he's just about, is he going to be able to carry on? He should be good. But I think, Matteo Banfo, that's what I mean, right? You can go into the world and you can have big dreams and you can have all of these things, and you've just got to know how to get there. And I think projects like this kind of can put you on the right path to say, right, because I only found out the other day, I don't know if you guys had them in the US, when we were in high school, and it was, mind you, a good 30-odd years ago for me, we had these careers advisor. Now, the wonderful job of the careers advisor was to be able to basically go out and help you in, to get onto the career that, you wanted to do. I did find a lot of time when you went in there and you spoke to her about sports, like I play football, that was it, or soccer as you guys call it, and all I wanted to do was play football. And she instantly turned around and said to me, well, son, you haven't got a lot of chance of that. One in a million people make it through and all this. And they weren't very supportive. And I think projects like this can put young people on the map and say, do you know what? You can go and do that. You don't have to, there's no shelf, there's no ceiling for you to sit on. You can go and do it. And I think that's the important thing, Matteo, here as well, don't you think? Banfo, sorry.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think success happens through very, very hard work and a series of failures. And then the build of the car, we've seen throughout the years, that's exactly what happens. I think, kids that build the car go through a process of, failing and failing better and then succeeding at the end. And so I think it gives you an idea of what reality is. I mean, a lot of the time we assume that people who make it, they just make it. But I think it's all about persistence and powering through difficult moments, which we all have in our career, and, try to keep the end goal in mind.
I think that's the thing. Set your path out, get your goal, and figure out how you're going to get there. and there's plenty of people around there to help you. And the young people I spoke to up at Bristol College were in the same boat when we went in there. You know, they did a World for Works where speakers come in from different categories of life, you know, and you can't get much different to me sitting in my office at home talking about pretend race cars at pretend race circuits, right? Let's be real about it, and making a business out of it. And I think that's the thing. There's too many sometimes borders and barriers put up for young people, and not given the right path, or they're not given the right information, or, you know, they're always told no. And I think that's the biggest thing. Never take a no as final. Go and do it. Mm-hmm. Go and give it a go. And I think that's what they've got to look out for, Matteo Banfo, as well.
Yeah, and I'm from Europe as well. And so I think it's I have to say, I don't want to throw shade at, you know, a country that I love, but I think it's a European mentality, definitely an Italian mentality, to just say, oh, you'll never make it, just give up, don't even try. And I think it's the wrong one, absolutely the wrong one.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's always a path, you just need to find the right one.
Exactly, and that's the thing. You've got to make sure that you can find your path. Always make sure you find your path. Never take no for an answer. If you work hard enough and your goals are big enough and your dreams are big enough, go and do it. Doesn't matter from where you're from, who you're from, how you're from, what country you're from, what religion, race, or anything like that. The doors are always open, and you've got to go and make sure that you fulfill your dreams. This isn't a rerun. It is a one-time deal. So go out and fill it and do it the best you can at the moment. And I can tell you one thing here, Pius. Sean Houlihan is going out and doing just that, as he's now nearly touching on a 27-second lead here with 6 minutes to go.
Well, it's almost looks like it's become a battle for second at this point. However, there's still some races here to go. Are all the pits utilized?
They've all gone. Yeah, they've all done. Everybody's in.
Well, it might be Rap City then, but I'll tell you what. What a wonderful human being that gentleman is, and that team, and all they've done. They've really set a great standard, a new standard for excellence over there. They really are going hard. Ketchum is not playing games in 20.
No, they're definitely not. I think that's the thing. I think as well, some people in this race, right, and Sean O'Han's gone and done what we kind of expected him to do. He's gone out, he's taken the lead, he's done a great job. David Searles, another one we expected to be consistent and settled in. We all had a good old big up of Blythe Miller, and I think Blythe's come into the car and realized this is not easy. You know, he's had a bit of a rough time. He's been in the pits twice. He's had some spins. And I think Matteo Lundgren, that Blythe's probably come out of this a little bit humbled on to how he goes in. You know, you all picked him up. You said he was incredible. He was going to do this. And he's really struggled here today.
Yeah, I mean, you sometimes have off days. And I always think, too, that your starting point really determines a lot in these races that we've witnessed here with the Winner's Circle Project. But, yeah, you know, Blythe has been, you know, on the radar for the Owego team since the beginning of the year, you know, posting a lot of fast times in practice when they're running, you know, practice races and practicing. So yeah, it's a surprise to me to see him in this spot, but you know, you gotta take it with your chin up and take it as a learning lesson, and you just move forward. That's how I see Blythe today.
Yeah, it's a character building, and I think Blythe has just got a big old character shock, because he's come in, as I say, posting fast times. And unfortunately, the car has bitten him, and the track has bitten him a little bit today. He's now three laps down from the leader. We've got Nick, who's two laps down at the moment from Double J. We've got Vlad, who's only a lap down, mind you, and he's gone in and done his pit stop. And I've got a funny feeling, as we were talking, Blythe has done the same thing again, going into turn one, not hitting that braking point. As I said, turn one was very tricky for me. I couldn't hit it. I had to brake well back to get these cars to stop. And unfortunately, it looks like Blythe has just done another little bit of a ta-ta-ta. We won't look back and compound this young man's, unfortunate race here. But I tell you what we can do is big up the man from FDR, Vlad Slater, here, Pius. He's done a great job starting at the back and has worked his way up into third.
Those presidents, you can never sleep on those presidents. really can't. They're built a certain way out there, the FDR. You know, home of one of the greatest presidents ever, obviously. You know, they come from that cloth. A man that ran the world from a sitting position, you know? So you come from that cloth. So I see Vlad, he's of that racing cloth, and I gotta tell you, I think you're gonna see Vlad in real cars soon. I really have that kind of feeling about a guy like that. He will be racing against everybody else in the go-kart trip that we're gonna be having at Factory 5. Mateo Lundgren, tell us a little bit about Factory 5 trip that we're gonna be coming up soon.
Yeah, we're excited to bring this all the teams on a trip to the Factory 5 manufacturing facility where they get to see where the cars, all the parts, everything they ordered for their car kit, how they're made and where they're made, and get to meet Dave Smith, who's a great partner of ours for the Winter Circle project, and tour the facility where these car kits are all manufactured. You know, we try to create a lot of cool experiences where students not only get to see new things, but meet people and network for chances, you know, beyond the classroom, jobs and whatnot. And Factory 5 is just one of many partners we have. So this is an exciting trip for our students. It's overnight. We'll actually be racing, James, you might like this. We'll be racing on the largest indoor go-kart track in our country as part of an event. So these kids will not be racing each other on simulators, they'll be racing in real life. That'll be fun. That's always a fun part of our trip.
Yeah, I'm just waiting, Pius, just to send me over the plane ticket, Mateo, to get me on that trip so I can go and enjoy the go-karting as well. I'm just dropping the hint now, Pius, while I'm there. I think it's going to be great fun for them, and to get them all together and really sort of socialize. Yeah, they're they are a school, they are a separate entity, and they are battling it all out for the WCP championship. But at the same time, it's all about making friends and keeping friends together. And these guys have done a great job. I can tell you now as well, we are at Sean Houlihan is on the final lap of the race. I think he's just about not going to make one more lap here. So he's going to come round. Well, he's got 10 seconds. He's at the top left of the circuit. Round okay. Turn four, dropping down the hill. He's not going to make it. I think the time is going to run out before he gets there. And it will be Ketchum taking the checkered flag. You can see the man on the right-hand side waving frantically. And it's going to be Sean O'Houlihan who's going to take the victory here at Lime Rock. Wow. Yes, you can go and do donuts. There's a stellar job from him. David Searles, so close, did a great job closing the gap. He got within that 1 second magic marker and then unfortunately made the mistake that cost him on the final corner, but he comes over the line in second place. Yep. There as well, Vlad Slater, the man who's climbed up positions, I think he's gonna actually come over the line in third, but he'll be last on track as Nick Pappas comes over there for John Jay. He finishes in fourth. Blythe Miller, who's had a little bit of a rough one, bit of an eye-opener, take it on the chin some, come back next time, I'm sure you'll be great. And then Vlad Slater comes over the line in third place. So a great job.
One thing I will say for Blythe Miller, though, is he's a winner in real life. I mean, this man, you know, the good thing is I know there was a tough loss today, but overall, he is definitely a winner in life. We're very proud of Blythe. He's going to be, doing a little bit of some time on the actual pits at Lime Rock with the tech team. So it's going to be quite a weekend for him. And Mateo, you want to talk a little bit about that partnership?
Yeah, it's an apprenticeship. Partnership we have with the tech director for the Trans Am series. His name is Aaron Colwell, great guy. And so we have two students this year that are going to be volunteering with a tech team, learning with a tech team, checking all the cars that get on each track at Lime Rock and at Watkins Glen this year with the Trans Am race series. So that's going to be exciting for our students to not only, you know, pick up on skills, watch how all of these things happen, but meet a lot of people and perhaps create in a, you know, a job opportunity for themselves.
Absolutely. Well, let's bring you up the final session results. It was Sean Houlihan in first place from Ketchum, with David Searles in second from Waverley. Vlad Slayer up two places from FDR there in third. And it's Nick Pappas in fourth. Of course, it's Blythe Miller and not Nick Rogers in the car in fifth for Owego. So as we stated earlier on, if they finished where they finished, they would be in the places that I have said. And guess what's happened? They finished where they finished. So at the moment, it should be Ketchum in first, Waverley in second, Double J in third, only just by 0.75. Owego in fourth. And I can tell you now, Vlad Slater has given FDR a big old boost there to get within the mix. He is literally less than 20 points back from Waverley, who are sitting in second. So it's not all done here, Pius. Yeah. There's still time, there's still chances, and FDR can still come through.
This is going to be one of the most exciting finishes of the Winter Circle Project Championship. And we're going to be handing out that Michael Spencer Award on the 24th to a team that really is going to deserve it. It's going to be so exciting. The end of this actual virtual race, but also the championship on the 24th, you know, the year of the Mamba, you know, so... It's just going to be fitting that we're going to be at Lime Rock and someone's actually going to win an award for real. It's just exciting. It's just exciting. And I got to tell you, James, that you might have to get a ticket for, my friend. That is the event to be at.
Wow.
On the 24th at Lime Rock.
We'll
that
have
is
a,
the event, my friend.
I was going to talk to you about that, but we'll have a chat after on that one. We're joined by Matthew Overton from SGS, the guys who have designed these cars and put these in for these young guys here as well. Absolutely stellar job. Matthew, welcome in, buddy. How are you?
I'm doing great, thank you. Really enjoyed the race. Some super stuff, and I was really pleased to see all five drivers finish the race and in running order. So that was really nice. Bit spread out and some excitement during it, but just a great race. And I've got Sean waiting to come on in and have a chat with you.
Yeah, let's bring him in and we'll have a chat with the winner here as well. So we'll just wait for Matt to go and have a chat with him, make sure the young man's ready, of course. A little bit, you know, could be a little bit nervous coming into the booth.
Congratulations to those guys.
Yeah, congratulations.
Can I say,
you know, I would have loved to see what Sean would have done, because David had him at about 0.5 seconds. I can't wait to hear what happened with Sean in that spot, because, you know, David was trying to pass him and make that move, and he made a, you know, fatal error. That's when he spun out.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what we can do. We've got Sean into the booth. Sean, welcome in, bud. How are you?
I'm doing good. It was a good race.
It was a good race. You were out in front.
Great race.
Out in front by about 3 seconds at one point. David then brought your gap down to 0.5, I believe it got down to as well. How tough was it almost being hunted there as well? Because David was coming.
It was a good battle. I'm sorry he crashed. It was going to be a good race if he stayed with it.
Yeah, I think it would have been there as well. How tough out there is it in these cars? As I said earlier on, I took these cars for a little bit of a spin, right? Out of 5 laps, I made it round once. So you've done better than me because I ended up in a barrier somewhere and turning the car into a lawnmower. How tough is it out there? Tell us from your side of things how tough it is controlling these cars.
I think a lot of it is just a lot of practice and you got to get used to it. And setting up the car the right way really helps a lot.
And who helped you with that one?
Mark and his son actually helped me, but so is my classmate that's sitting next to me right now. We took a lot of time and dialed it in.
Yeah, well, you did an absolutely stellar job, dear sir, as well, and a great win from you. I can tell you what we will do. Let's give you a chance. Anyone you want to shout out before we let you go?
I'll shout out my teacher, Mr. Bliss, you know, giving me the opportunity to take his class. And I guess my kind of crew chief, Cody, he's sitting right next to me, letting me know what I should do, when to pit and all that stuff.
What's up, Cody?
What about your parents? Because, you know, without them.
They're watching. I hope they're watching right now. I know. Shout out to you guys. Thank you for supporting me.
Yeah, shout out to his parents as well.
Listen, I gotta ask you, are you gonna be on that trip?
Yes, I will be.
Are you excited for that trip, my friend?
I'm very excited. I can't wait. I can't believe it's coming up already.
Well, let me ask you this. What is it that makes the Winner's Circle to you? What does the Winner's Circle actually mean to you as an organization? What is it that you like about this?
My favorite thing about it is the opportunity that you gave us to do something that most schools or kids will never get to experience in their life, even if they're passionate about it. I'm like really grateful for that. I actually really enjoy this class. I'm glad I took it.
See? Good man, my friend. I appreciate you. We appreciate you. And we love that experience and the fact that you're taking advantage of your opportunities and maximizing all of your, you know, energy and potential. And we love you on this team, and we're very proud of you. And we're proud you made your whole team, your family, and definitely the Winner's Circle Project family all proud. So keep doing what you guys are doing. What have you learned so far in Mr. Bliss's class that is different than other classes?
I feel like I get to work. Since we have the two periods to work on, I feel like you get a lot closer with the teacher and you get a lot closer with your classmates. And like, we can really like connect on stuff when we're working on it. And when we have ideas, we can all share them equally and listen to each other.
Amazing. Amazing. So we're learning real teamwork in the real time.
Yeah.
Well, amazing, and kudos to you. Anything you want to add, Mateo Lundgren?
No, it was a great race. It was just overall great race. I can't wait to see what happens next. It's an exciting year, and we're closing into the end here.
All right. Well, make sure. Well, it was great talking to you. And make sure you guys stay steady. You know, don't get gassed up. You got to stay focused. Right.
All right, well, there you go. I think we have. We can pop Sean back up into the waiting room. Sean, thanks so much. Congratulations on your win again. This amazing job from you. Right, well, that's going to wrap things up here, guys, as well. We're just coming into the end of the broadcast. Thanks so much for joining us. Hope you've all enjoyed yourself there as well. Charles Williams, the competition couldn't survive the storm, he said. Sean O'Halloran. Halloran did go and absolutely take it to the rest of the field. But that's going to wrap it up here. Once more, up here in the Winner Circus Project booth, I've been James Parfitt. I've been alongside Pius. Been alongside Mateo Benfo and Mateo Lundgren. But for now, guys, as always, take care, have a great week, and you never know, we might see you next time. Good night.